Thank you, sir. And I agree with you totally that these are very complex cases. And no matter how much experienced you are, you still feel jittery before a myopic foveochitis case. So pathological myopia, just a short brief. Pathological myopia is globe elongation and a refractive error of at least minus 8 diopters or axial length of greater than 26.5 mm, which is associated with degenerative changes in the retina. And it varies considerably in different geographical regions, the highest prevalence being in the Asian population. And pathological myopia has a very high disease burden. And myopic foveochitis is, you know, present in about 30 to 40% of patients having more than 8 diopters or more myopia. So what happens is there is excessive axial elongation of the eye, which results in the mechanical stretching and thinning of the choroid RPE, thereby causing various degenerative changes in the retina. And then we have what we see is the posterior cephaloma, choroidal atrophy, lacquer cracks, macular hemorrhages, CNVMs, myopic foveochitis, and then finally culminating to myopic macular hole. So I'll be discussing not the buccal part in myopic foveochitis because I don't do that. I do vitrectomy. So I'll be discussing the past pinna vitrectomy part and the unique problems which we face in myopic foveochitis. And there are four categories which are the main hurdles for the surgery. First is the visualization of the posterior hole. The length of the eyeball, of course, because these are long eyes. The PVT induction is very difficult in these eyes and carries unique challenges. And the common technique, which can be, you know, reproduced again and again and give you consistent results. So starting with the visualization, I feel that in these eyes, even a slight amount of cataract gives you a tremendous amount of, you know, optical aberrations. So these are not like routine macular hole surgeries or posterior hole surgeries where you can do with some amount of lenticular opacities. So if my take is here, if the patient is 40 or above and he has a myopic foveochitis, even a slight lenticular opacity, I'll go with a combined phacovitrectomy, and implanting a lens gives you excellent clarity of the posterior pole. So this is a case of, you know, combined phacovitrectomy in a myopic foveochitis case. And you can see the lens was not that much, you know, opaque, but still, you know, during the surgery and during the wide angle peel, you can see the posterior pole, the ILM, and these eyes have low contrast at the posterior pole. So it becomes, you know, very difficult to, you know, visualize the membranes. And lens in place, IOL in place, you know, really helps in that. So this is the case where we did a phacovitrectomy and a large diameter ILM peel. Coming to the length, that is the main problem, and the instruments commercially available to us actually do not conform to the length of the you know, pathological myopia. And there are a few ways of, you know, circumventing these problems. The first is the most common way, to make you know, a little posterior ports. So in, you know, myopes more than 29.5 or more axial length, you can make a port around 4.5 or even 5 mm to reach the posterior port. You can, you know, use customized forceps from various manufacturers for these eyes. This was a case of posterior cephaloma and myopic foveochitis with posterior pole RD. And in this case, the axial length was more than 30 mmHg. And even a 5 mm, you know, trocar cannula system from the limbus, we were not able to reach the posterior pole. And the main problem was in these eyes, when you're going that much posterior, your forceps, you know, tends to be vertical. And while holding it, and the shaft of the forceps, you know, touches the edge of the non-contact viewing system, and, you know, that, you know, distorts your view again and again. So my view here is that although I also do you know, macular peeling most of the cases with a wide angle system, non-contact system only these days, but in some select cases like this, you know, you should use the contact irrigating system, and that, you know, helps you a lot. It gives you a, you know, excellent magnification, excellent resolution. And the problem of touching the forceps with the non-contact viewing system is, you know, circumvented. And these cases become really simple. As you can see now, the peel is done, you know, effortlessly because of a good view and less distortion because the image is stable. So the other is you can do is that if you're ambidextrous and your right hand is not reaching, in right-handed individuals not reaching the posterior pole, you can always come, you know, make asymmetrical ports, and your left hand might reach it, And this was one case in which my right hand was not reaching the posterior pole. So I started the peeling with my left hand. And you can see I can easily reach the posterior pole and do the alum peeling comfortably. It takes some practice, but when you know, lift the flap and it becomes easy and it's not very difficult as it seems to be. So that is one way of, you know, circumventing the problem of high axial limb. The last point is the PVD induction. The PVD induction in these cases is very difficult, and as much as you seem to believe that PVD has been induced by pulling and injecting tricot and there is no tricot crystals left on the surface, you'll rest assured there will be some amount of cortical vitrocheresis left which needs to be peeled, and you know it, if not peeled, it, you know, 100% results in a recurrence or a failed surgery. So there are two ways of doing that. One way is what we described in pediatric RDs. So in that works beautifully in, you know, patients who have around 28 or 29 mm of axial length, and you do a core vitrectomy, you inject triamcinolone acetonide, and then you inject, you know, a small amount of bubble of PFCL. So we have stained the vitreous, and now, you know, we are injecting a small amount of PFCL till the arcades only, and then we try to make a cleavage plane in the hyaloid layer. We make a hole, and you know, we grasp the edge of the hole anteriorly so that it enlarges, and then with the blunt instrument, maybe the light pipe in your other hand, you just swipe it around and make a PFCL well. So what a PFCL well is, that when your hole is enlarged, you push the PFCL inside that hole, so the PFCL bubble is lying between the hyaloid and the retina. So this we have been doing routinely in pediatric cases, but it works wonders in this case also. So the advantage here is that the PFCL protects the retina, underlying retina, so it's a very atraumatic procedure. And it ensures a complete PVD. It's atraumatic because once you have that edge, you can inject more PFCL and enlarge the well, and you can have an atraumatic PVD cleavage till the equator. Of course, after that you can use the cutter to extend the to enlarge and extend the PVD. So this is the PFCL which has gone into the subhyaloid space and it's overlying retina, and the rest maneuvers are similar. But this technique, what I just described, does not work in high axial length, more than 30 mmHg, like in this case I'm going to describe. Because what happens is, when you inject PFCL, the axial length further increases if there is posterior pole fluid. So it becomes difficult, you know, to go to the macula. So in, you know, very high axial length pathological myopias, you don't use PFCL. It will be more difficult in those cases. You just use a combination of forceps and a cutter, and be a little patient, find the cleavage plane, like in this case, you lift it with the forceps edge, then you use, you know, moderate suction with the cutter. With the combination of these instruments, it takes a little time. You have to, you know, remove that cortical vitreous to, you know, get your posterior pole and then stain it with BBG, because without that, it will not take up the stain. So these are difficult cases, and we frequently encounter, you know, complications and re-RDs and, you know, suboptimal closures of macular holes in these cases. One of these cases was operated somewhere else outside Jaipur and came to us with a re-RD, and the diagnosis, the primary diagnosis was, you know, myopic macular hole, and ended up in a RD, and we, you know, stained it with triamcinolone acetonide. It did not take up any stain. Then we, you know, stained it with trypan blue, and then we found a whole, you know, sheet of precortical vitreous lying over the posterior pole, as you can see here. And then we gently peeled up all the attachments of that membrane and, you know, removed it en masse. And you know, the appendages were, you know, extended to the periphery beyond the arcade, and finally we could make the retina mobile, and we injected BBG over the posterior pole after that, and injected PFCL, and did some alum peeling, and the patient did well and had no recurrence even after oil removal. So if you don't remove that, you know, cortical vitreous, there is a 100% chance that you will end up in re-RDs or a closed macular hole or non-settlement of the fovea. But even all the after all the maneuvers, you still, you know, end up in type 2 closures or the non-resolving of the fluid of the posterior pole and suboptimal visual outcomes. So what we have learned over the past few years, we have, you know, developed a common protocol of what we follow in all these cases. And I'll, you know, just exemplify with my last video. So this is a 60-year-old female, one-eyed patient, and the right eye, the vision was finger counting close to face. The axial length was 30.34 and the eye was pseudophakic. And the diagnosis was myopic foveachitis with macular hole. So we made the ports around 4.5 to 5 mm from the limbus, and it's a highly myopic eye. You can see the low amount of contrast of the posterior pole, and the sclera is visible. After inducing the PVD, we again make it short, you know, multiple staining with the trimethoxazole acetonide is done, so that no amount of vitreous is left. After that, we inject Trepan Blue and Brilliant Blue to, you know, identify any ERMs or IRM. And as you can see, some amount, because there is a posterior pole fluid and the macula is elevated, some amount of dye goes inside the retina. It's subretinal, as you can see. So this is a very simple way of, you know, removing it. You just inject a small amount of PFCL on the nasal side. Here the BBG is being injected, and a small amount of PFCL is injected on the nasal side, and then you aspirate all the Trepan Blue. It pushes the dye from the subretinal space, and along with that you can aspirate all the fluid also. So the posterior pole becomes flat, and it's, you know, very safe to inject PFCL then, so that it does not go subretinally. And now you start your island peeling or any ERM peeling. So the idea here is, I'll just take a minute more. The idea here is to do a wide angle peeling. So the idea here is to do a wide angle peeling, and the peeling, you know, should, you know, approach the edge of the excavation. So if it is a small amount of peeling which suffices in routine macular holes, this will not do the job in these cases. So you have to identify the edge of the posterior pole, and, you know, you have to do a wide angle peeling which conforms to the excavation to make the retina more redundant, so that it can fall back and, you know, compensate with the high axial length. So the first, you know, initiation of the flap making is difficult because there is no contrast. But once it's folded over itself, the ILM, then it's a simple job, because now there is a, you know, a increased view of the ILM, and then you can, you know, pinch and grasp and, you know, re-pinch and re-grasp and do a wide angle peeling. And here the macular hole, in these cases, I always do, as Srinivas told, a multi-layered inverted ILM peeling, which we have been doing for many years now. We started with the RDs with macular hole. Now we do it in routine macular holes also with excellent type 1 closures. So the whole peel is, you know, extended till the excavation, which you can see is around here. And the peeled ILM is, you know, bunched up inside the hole. And it's not stuffed in actually, it's just bunched up, and a small tug is given. And after that, you go under ear and do a lot of interface vitrectomy for the periphery. And you can see the beauty of this technique is, you can see the blue dot in the center. And with all the maneuvers, you do a indentation vitrectomy also. The flap is stable. You remove the PFCL slowly, gently. And even after removal of the PFCL, that flap will remain in place, rest assured, if you have done adequate multiple layer inverted ILM peeling. So now we are, you know, aspirating the PFCL gently, and even after the last drop of PFCL has been aspirated, the blue plug is, you know, always there. And the other advantage of this technique is that you don't have to make a secondary retinotomy. So previously, when I started these cases, I was afraid that there will be posterior pole fluid, because when there is a PFCL over the posterior pole, it shifts the fluid, you know, in the periphery. Here you can see the fluid is in the periphery because of the PFCL. Now you make a second retinotomy, you can drain it, but it is traumatic. You don't, in this technique, you don't need to make a secondary retinotomy, and the fluid absorbs by itself in a couple of days. So post-operative 8 weeks, we had excellent results in this case, as in similar cases, and the visual acuity was 1.0 logmar, and we injected C3F8, no oil was needed. So to conclude, myopic fovea with macular hole is a complex surgery with the varied intraoperative surprises. So with the myopic fovea with macular hole, you do the technique which I described. It is very useful. And without macular hole, you try to avoid the macula, the fovea, because you can deroof the thin retina. You do a fovea sparing ILM peeling. Of course, a thorough preoperative workup and planning is needed for the desired outcomes. And the various steps here are combined procedures of phaco vitrectomy, complete PVD induction with multiple staining, and posterior ports around 4.5 to 5 mm are the key to success. Having said that, a thorough preoperative counseling with a very clear communication to the patient and the attendants about the chance of failure, late reopening of holes, and even everything has gone right, a modest improvement of vision should be done clearly. Thank you.